Mark Gilbert, thanks for coming down.
Thanks for having us, Jay.
Appreciate you being down here. So you're the president of Commercial Data Systems, mm-hmm. and you're right in the mainstream on what's going on in information technology mm-hmm. in Hawaii. And from time to time, we like to talk to you about that and get current. So can you tell us, you know, top down, what's going on? What's happening in information technology right now? Who's doing what?
Well, I think there's actually two interesting trends that we're seeing that are being adopted now. And they're not really related, but they could be. You could see them as being related. And the first is application appliances. And the second is a topology called thin provisioning. Those are two brand new, actually they're not that new, they're what's old is new again, but reinventions with modern technology of ways that we are doing IT. The first one, application appliances. So what we used to have was a traditional stovepipe structure. You would have the server, you would have the storage, and you would have the application on top of it. And you'd go to a server manufacturer, and you'd buy your server. You go to the storage manufacturer, you'd buy your storage. You go to the software manufacturer, you buy your software. And then you would integrate it yourself and create a solution. What we're seeing now is that people are coming out and they are integrating, the OEMs are integrating the entire stack themselves and presenting you with an appliance that isn't necessarily plug and play, but is allows you to easily get spun up on these very complex software products. One example of that is Oracle. Oracle Corporation, I know we had the discussion where they purchased Sun Microsystems, mm-hmm. a hardware manufacturer. That, yeah. So everyone was wondering, is Oracle really going to get into the hardware business? And the answer to that is yes. They are actually doubling the amount of sales reps that the hardware side had, the Sun hardware side had. They are putting a lot of aggressive development into the hardware platforms. Now, why would they do this? A software company that's known for databases.
Isn't the rule that you stay with what you know best?
Well, that's the problem is you're seeing all this consolidation. You're seeing HP just bought a professional services organization called EDS. IBM already had their global services group, and they had their own software group. So you're seeing this consolidation. Even Cisco, who's known as a networking house, now has a line of servers that integrate with its networking gear. So you're seeing this consolidation in the industry where the customer wants to go to one place for the entire totality of the solution. What Oracle is doing, even though they traditionally don't know anything about hardware, is they are integrating all of the Sun hardware to including storage, including servers, including their software, and creating these appliances. They call it Exadata. The Exadata is actually an Oracle database appliance. Now, what can Oracle do that someone buying bits and pieces together can't? They know their software so well, they can tune it so nicely to the Sun hardware platform that they can come out with a lower cost system that significantly outperforms what you can do by doing the bits and pieces yourself.
And less risk of a crash, of a lockup.
That's one of the interesting things. So whenever you go buy your servers from one place and your storage from another place and your applications from another place and your OS from another place, when something goes wrong, who do you call?
Right.
The application guy will say, it's not my fault, it's the OS guy. The OS guy will say, no, you got a server problem, call the server guy. The server guy will say, no, you set up your storage topology wrong. What this does is it eliminates that. There is one phone call. There is one support organization for your Oracle database. Now, they're going to see a lot more of these start to come out. You're going to start to see a lot more appliances, you know, for CRM packages, customer resource management, for ERP, employee resource management. You're going to start seeing these stovepipe appliances come out that are highly integrated and highly tuned and much higher performance.
You know, there was always a benefit in avoiding multiple, you know, he went that away mm-hmm. type combinations. So this is sort of an advanced form of the same thing.
Yeah, and the one thing that IT departments traditionally have wanted to do is they wanted to get the server guys to compete, different server platforms to compete so you can get a better price, different storage platforms to compete so you can get a better price, different software platforms. Now, the complexity has gotten so great that even if you get a little better price, the complexity of putting this integrated solution together by yourself is so much overwhelmingly more expensive that, frankly, it's less expensive to pay a little more for one manufacturer's total solution and have it totally integrated and highly tuned to whatever database you were running. So we're going back to that more of a mainframe model, where when you had a mainframe back in the 60s, you bought from one manufacturer. It was usually IBM. You paid one price, it was a lot of money, but it worked.
Well, now, how does this affect, Mark, how does this affect the industry here in Hawaii? So now we have these new integrated stovepipe solutions.
Mm-hmm. Well, you're going to start seeing it affect it because the mainland is already starting to adopt this. And Hawaii usually lags the mainland within a year or two. The fact is that as these refresh cycles come with the major IT consumers in Hawaii, you know, the banks, the medical groups, they will start to look at these as ways to ease cost actually out of the system, because these appliances are so much easier to administer that that's what drives cost. The most expensive part about a computer solution is not purchasing the hardware. It's administering the box. It's the man hours to keep it up and running. So if you can use a lot less man hours on your Oracle database, on your SAP middleware implementation, on any of these, if you can use a lot, make it more efficient, make it easier to manage, the cost savings will be dramatic in the long term. And they're already seeing that on the mainland with a lot of these implementations that are going on. So initially people have sticker shock at the price. They'll say, my God, $1 million? I can go buy the hardware by myself for $500,000 and integrate it myself. Well, guess what? $500,000 is very little when it comes to the administration cost side of the equation. So that's what the IT directors are starting to do, and you're starting to see that more. You're starting to see the IT guys at the larger computer consumers say, wait a second, I need to factor in the cost of my administration, the bodies that administer, sure, and how that affects the quality of the service, the IT service that I can
total
give.
Cost.
Yes.
Yeah. But I mean, I worry for you. I'll tell you why, because you know, they could advertise sort of the way the drug companies advertise, mm-hmm, directly to the consumer,
mm-hmm,
and say, yeah, you don't really need anybody to advise you about this. Here's a solution for you. And then where does that put you? Are you still relevant to a customer who can buy this stuff, who can figure it out and buy the stuff himself?
Well, that's I'm always fond of saying that CDS is not the same company we were 3 years ago, and we better not be the same company 3 years from now that we are today. So how do we play in that environment? It becomes more of a services generated model. It's not about pushing a lot of hardware, it's about helping the customer deploy these unique solutions. So you've seen actually CDS start to migrate away from just pushing hardware, 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 to the point now that we generate a fifth of our profit on a monthly basis on billable hours, and that is expected to double this year. So that's the model. The model is changing. The big guys, the big OEMs, are collapsing. They're creating fewer and fewer places to go shop at. They're creating more integrated solutions. So that does endanger a typical reseller that just focuses on selling hardware. Now it's about the solution that you have to sell.
So your involvement is the customer calls you. Does he say, look, Mark, find, you know, a solution for me? Or does he say, you know, I saw this Cisco stovepipe, mm-hmm, solution. I'd like you to get that, and then you can maintain it for me later. I mean, how has your role in the process changed?
Well, the role in the process becomes that you have to come in at a much higher level and much earlier in the sales process. Traditionally in the past, typical resellers, like what CDS was in the past, the customer would decide what kind of server they wanted. They'd call us. They'd call two other resellers. We'd give them a price quote. They'd decide who they want to do with. Now, you need to be in the IT shop as they're making determinations of where they are going and what future they are going to. Give you a good example of this. Mm-hmm. University of New Mexico wants to create a cloud. We've discussed clouds before. They want to create an IT cloud that provides services to all of the community, the college community, and maybe the greater community at large. But they're the very early phases of discussing this. So they actually brought CDS in and our expertise in clouds and virtualization and said, how do we do it? So I actually flew out there and did a presentation to the entire IT group at University of New Mexico. We gave them some ideas, and now we're in partnership with them to help them pick the best solution, to help them understand where they can go from here. So that's where resellers like CDS need to grow up. We need to become more consultative to our customer base.
Yeah, well, that's a better role, isn't it?
It's a lot funner.
You're a partner now, and you're part of the program, and you can offer them the latest and greatest. They can't keep up. You can keep up. So you can be their planning consultant.
Yeah, I can be like their CTO. Yeah, I can be their chief technology officer. I can say, I'm going to go research all the really cool stuff. We're going to partner together. And even if the manufacturer is aware that I'm working the deal, they'll keep me included. They're not going to remove me out, because most manufacturers are really appreciative if you have that kind of relationship with your customer, that you are a consultant and a trusted advisor. You'll have a strong hand. It doesn't matter. Those resellers who typically in the past just fulfilled product, that model is dying. Mm, and it will be a dead model.
Interesting. God, you got to watch the ball all the time.
Well, that was our model for 6-7 years. It was about 4 or 5 years ago that we started saying, okay, we need to get more involved on the services side. We need to get more involved in being that trusted advisor. And part of that, frankly, is being agnostic. The worst thing you can do as a reseller is say, I sell this line, buy this line for me.
Yeah, that's scary for the customer.
Yes, it's better to say, what's your problem? Okay, well, you could skin it this way. You could skin it this way. You could skin it this way. Mm-hmm. This is the way I would go, but if you have a preference for this manufacturer, this is how you could do it here.
So now in New Mexico or anywhere else, once you make the decision to buy this stovepipe and this solution, what's the likelihood they're going to hold on to you? Or, you know, are they just going to move off and say, well, we don't need anybody right now. Thanks a lot, Mark.
Unfortunately, we call it an appliance, like it's supposed to be really easy. It needs ongoing care and nurturing.
What kind of care and nurturing?
If you're talking a Oracle database, most of our customers don't really have that quality of DBs, database administrators, to help. They need to constantly be looking at upgrades, patches, all of those types of things. And then we have expertise in that. And a lot of these IT shops don't. That's just it's not in their DNA to do that.
So you can operate remotely from Hawaii.
Yes.
You can help them on database issues, and it's a regular kind of a maintenance
exactly.
function.
Then you go into where you're doing a monthly retainer, where you are actually, they keep you for X many allotted hours on a monthly retainer. And then that becomes reoccurring revenue, which actually evens out your revenue stream and makes it a lot easier to stay in business through the highs and lows.
It's good when you want to talk to a banker also.
Yeah, exactly. If you want a loan and you got reoccurring revenue, it's a lot easier
like
to
a maintenance
get.
Agreement, you know, you
yeah,
can
exactly.
take it to the bank.
Exactly.
You know, I've been reading and worrying about, hacker attacks, or worse, you know, snooping and sniping from afar. Mm-hmm. When you get into these big systems, don't you have to worry about that? How do you prevent the university of whatever it is from being hacked from afar?
Well, actually, this is whether you do an appliance-based solution like the Oracle Exadata solution, or you do a virtualized cloud solution, because these are actually two different types of solution. An appliance is still kind of a stovepipe solution. Virtualization is more of a mainframe, have all kinds of different applications running. As you consolidate, the real key to these technologies is consolidation. You're going to fewer systems, you're going to fewer storage enclaves. So it's actually a lot easier to nail down fewer systems than the typical client server sprawl that a lot of our clients have. So security is one of the reasons you do this. One of the reasons you virtualize your environment and you take it to fewer servers is because it's much easier to lock down fewer physical servers. You still have to lock down the virtual servers, but the physical servers themselves can be locked down easier. The storage enclaves can be locked down easier. So it's about simplification. Once again, I like saying it, we're going back to the future. We're going back to the mainframe model. We had this model where we had this client server sprawl. For every application I had a server, every desktop had its own fat client, a PC that had to be updated. All of them weren't being updated properly, and it just sprawled. The easiest way to fix that solution is bring everything back to a unified architecture from both the storage, server, and application perspective. That makes it a lot easier to lock down.
Isn't that interesting? So back to the future, it helps if you were back at the past,
yeah.
and then you knew about the mainframe model, that would actually help you.
The first instance of virtualization in an OS was an IBM mainframe in the 60s. That was the first, so we are going back to that model. Which actually leads me into one of the other hot subjects we're doing right now. Well, that brings up the second area of excitement in the industry, and it is another one of those areas that has been promised for the last 10 to 12 years. And oddly enough, Larry Ellison with Oracle, 12 years ago, was one of the first adopters of this topology and then abandoned it. And that's called the thin client, or thin client provisioning. The thin client takes the concept of the desktop and turns it upside down on its head. The desktop is no longer that. It's no longer a desktop. It could be a desktop delivery to my phone. This could become the new desktop because the desktop no longer resides here. The desktop resides in a server back in the data center. It is a virtual desktop. And I can provision those desktops and I can sit and create 200 new desktops and push them out to whatever device you want me to. Now, as an industry, we have been after this for a very long time. Like I said, Larry Ellison came up with what he coined the network computer And this was in about 88, 89. And it was one of the first attempts at thin client, where once again, the server holds all the information, all the desktop information, and what's blown out to the actual desktop is an image. It's just an image.
Mm-hmm.
And nothing resides here. Nothing resides on my phone anymore. The problem with that, the problem with that was network bandwidth. Because one thing, if you're blowing a bunch of files on the network, your network has to be very robust. And at that time, all we had was 10 base T. We had, mm-hmm. 10 megabit Ethernet. So everyone kept trying to create these thin clients, and they never performed well. Now, was it the thin clients, the physical thin clients' fault? No, it wasn't the fault of the thin client at all. But what do we like to do as a group of IT professionals? We like to shoot the messenger. So whenever the thin client didn't work, people were like, get this thing off my desk. Just get it out of here. About 3 or 4 years ago, when network topology started speeding up enough to the point that you can deliver a rich user experience in a thin client, as you brought these thin clients out to the customers, they would show them to the end users, and the end users would say, absolutely not. I remember, these things are junk. These things are junk. And most of the times, the deployments of thin clients were junk, because the one thing that is most important on a deployment of a thin client is how you architect the back end. If you don't change your architecture on the back end, and you just expect a robust thin client experience, you're doomed. So no one was changing the architecture on the back end. We didn't really have the best practices and understand how to do that. Now we do. So now the underground movement by IT directors all over the place, even though they know their end users are going to scream initially, is going to this thin client topology.
It's easier on them, isn't it?
I can manage from one central storage. I talked about Back to the Future and the IBM model. What was the IBM model? It was a thin client. It was a little green terminal on the end of an R232 line. Everything was done in the mainframe. Nothing.
Well, that was the good old days.
And that's where we're going back. So, but now we're going to be able to deliver that desktop experience. We have to stop thinking of it as this is my desktop. We have to think of it as a desktop image. I can deliver it to a PDA. I can deliver it to a netbook. I can deliver it to whatever kind of attached, any device that is attached to the network.
How about an iPad?
Yes, you can easily deliver it to an iPad. You could deliver it to anything you want. So this is a big underground movement, and a lot of our customers are engaging us. There's even virtual PBX phone systems that you can have blown out to a thin client that has a USB, have a USB phone attached to it, and all of a sudden your thin client is just not a terminal for a computer, it's your phone. So that's where you're going to see this going. Eventually, we will stop talking about PCs. We will stop talking about Windows. We will talk about a desktop user experience that is delivered.
Where does SaaS, software as a service, play in all of that?
Well, software as a service is what some people end up doing. So, you have software as a service, infrastructure as a service, and platform as a service. I believe we've discussed this before. Software as a service will be, I will be able to go to Hawaii Telecom or AT&T and say, I not only want my compute resources from you, I want my phone from you, and I want it tied into either one device or two devices, a thin client and a phone. How much a month are you going to charge me per employee? And they will offload everything.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Now, the biggest downside of that is some people don't trust software as a service because there can be security concerns. You have to really trust who your service provider is. Right, you have to have these SLAs, these agreed upon levels of response, and a lot of the times they're not written strong enough, or they're never adhered to. So it's still, software as a service is still in its infancy. I mean, there are some huge examples. Obviously, Google Mail, Google Apps, it's a huge example of software as a service, but we're still not there, and it's not fully baked, because there is still in a lot of IT departments, and there will be for many, many years, particularly in the federal government side. I want to hug my server, right? I want the server in my room where I can walk down and I can see the blinky lights, and I want to make sure I possess it.
But there's not that much difference, though. The server is in my situation, my federal building, mm-hmm. whatever, or the server is far away, but it's still a server and you're still on a thin client watching it.
Yes, but if you want to hug your server,
I want to be physically close. Yeah, yeah.
Now, the government is going to create a lot of software as a service in some areas, but some areas because of security concerns, whether it be top secret classified data, what the enclave is like, they will never get there, or at least not for the immediate future. And the government tends to move slower, the federal government is adopting these standards. But the thin client itself, and as you see, these are all molding together, right? The virtualization enables me to do this. The whole idea of going back to the future. The IBM mainframe of the 60s was the software as a service. We are now going to create software in clouds as a service. So, I mean, that this is, and you add to that the fact that all the OEMs are combining, and they're all creating solutions that go up and down from the lowest level of the server to the storage to the spinning disk to the application that's where it's headed. It's consolidation. We are consolidating as an industry.
Mark, can you do encryption on this sort of thin client thing so that either on the wire or wireless, it can be encrypted? In other words, everything that comes across can be secure.
Absolutely. Everything can be secure. If you think about it, though, I mean, there's different ways to do it. For example, Sun Microsystems, now a division of Oracle, let's put that disclaimer in, they've been doing thin clients for years. Their thin client does it a different way. They have no local disk, no local low memory. If you can think about their thin client, it's basically the head on the end of a very long video cable. So the data that's being transferred isn't actual data, it's a video image, for lack of a better word, and it's encrypted. So this is basically a video adapter on the end of an Ethernet wire. So that is actually very easy to protect and very easy to encrypt. Now, every manufacturer has their own way to skin the cat of thin clients. HP has their thin client-based solutions. IBM partners with several companies on their thin client-based solutions. But I can tell you from my perspective of our customer base, thin client is probably even hotter right now than virtualization, even though they go hand in hand. Because in order to do thin clients, you got to do these virtual little desktop instances that you can propagate throughout your topology and throughout your environment.
So you say that it's hot, but do you think it's the coming thing? In other words, if I look 5 years from now, am I going to see thin clients everywhere, or could it go back to the future again?
I mean, eventually these are cycles. I guarantee you 5 years from now, because remember, I consider a phone, a PDA, a thin client. A netbook is a thin client. Even a standard desktop can be turned into a thin client.
Right.
You can actually put, in fact, a lot of our customers, they've invested in all these Dell desktops,
yeah.
Right? They don't want to just forklift them out.
Right.
So what you do is you actually put a little software stack inside the Dell that turns it into a thin client. Now, it kind of defeats the purpose because the other hot topic, obviously, is the greening of the data center and lowering energy costs. The advantage of the thin client pulls hardly any power versus a big, fat PC, which pulls a ton of power.
So you have an effect on the industry here.
Mm-hmm.
You have a consolidation of the big companies getting bigger. And if we go to thin clients, assuming we do, then they're smaller. They're cheaper, am I right?
Absolutely.
They take less power, but they also they don't cost as much.
Mm-hmm.
So how is that going to affect the hardware industry? That's got to change things for at least a couple of big manufacturers.
It particularly will affect the PC industry.
Yeah.
The PC industry, but you're seeing that now. They're evolving, right? So you see netbooks now all the time, $200-$300 netbooks. That's about the price of a thin client. So you are seeing the prices drive down, but the ability to have that full-featured $3,000 PC is going to, the people who need that much processing power in the desktop is going to shrink and shrink and shrink and shrink. And that's another thing about thin clients. Every consumer and every individual in an IT organization assumes they are a power user. They are convinced that they need that big power in the desktop. Every end user, I'm a power user. What do? I browse the web. I do Office.
You are not
a power user. You're not. Are you running Autodesk? Okay, now maybe you're a power user. But most people perceive of themselves as a power user.
When we finish with this tape, I'm going to put it on an Apple.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to process it. Takes a lot of memory. Takes a lot of processing power to do that. And I'm going to edit it and render it and so forth and disseminate it. So don't I need to be a power user to do that?
Well, you're different, Jay, because you are not part of a large organization that has an internal IT structure that can allocate you CPU cycles to do that.
But if I had an organization, I could put this tape on that.
Absolutely.
And so I wouldn't
Absolutely.
Need a powerful Apple.
Absolutely.
I could use a thin client.
You could use a thin client because you'd be running that task back at the data center where all the CPU cycles are.
So really, I mean, if it's cheaper to get the client, and if it's more efficient to have the a server that can handle it all in one place, that's the future. And I can expect one day that I'll be doing exactly that. No?
Where you might be doing it, even if you stay as a small shop, you'll be you'll be going to another company and taking their software as a service, and you'll say, I need X many cycles to do my work on this, and they'll say, here's how much we're charging you for it, and you just get on and you do it. You could do it with your iPhone.
Sure, and it's actually so much more efficient.
It's incredibly efficient. That's one of the other things that you see in the industry now, is that because we still have the hangover of the client-server topology, for lack of a better word, where we had server sprawl and storage sprawl and... Yeah, it reminds me of the tsunami warning we just had, right? Okay, so we had the tsunami warning. Every time there's a natural disaster in Hawaii, the next day, or if it's a weekend, on Monday, our phones start ringing off the hook, say, from people who in the IT industry who said, oh my God, we dodged a bullet. We got to get a disaster recovery plan. We've got to get disaster recovery. Because, you know, what if they had gone down? I didn't have anything backed up. Now, you know, it was a disaster. And we're like, okay, well, we can do an assessment. We can tell you how much and what we think the best way to go about this would be. And then we tell them how much it's going to be. And they freak out. They're like, it kind of costs that much to do disaster recovery? Now, why does it cost that much? Because I got 57 servers spread all over the place. I got 14 different storage enclaves, and each one has to be backed up separately. So one of the biggest advantages of consolidating your data center, virtualizing, reducing the amount of servers, reducing the amount of storage, making a more efficient IT department, is the cost to do DR on fewer machines is a lot less than the cost to do disaster recovery on 57 servers and 13 storage.
But you are also investing, you know, you are relying totally on that system, so that if some core element goes down in a system on which you are relying like that, you have a...
The Achilles heel. That's why going to fewer systems, it is so much more imperative that they're properly designed. Yeah. They have to be properly designed. It should not be, there should not be a fear factor of doing that, because there are industry standard ways to create a totally robust and replicable IT infrastructure that is secure, that has disaster recovery, that has fewer machines. It's when you cut corners and you don't do it right that you expose yourself.
Yeah, you want to go cheap now, you take a bigger risk.
But think of the savings. If you're not administering... We did an assessment for the VA in Florida. The VA in Florida didn't know how many servers they really had. They had systems all over the place. So we actually had to go in, put sniffers on their network, figure out where the servers was, do the virtualization assessment. Anyway, it was a mess. Found out they had about 580 identified Windows servers.
God.
Spread everywhere. So we came back to them with a moderately aggressive plan, well, not even the most aggressive plan, that actually reduced that server count to 40.
It's one-tenth, less than one-tenth.
Imagine how much easier it is to protect 40 servers than 580 servers. And we were going to give them better performance, easier manageability, and an ability to disaster recovery, which they had no ability to do.
Well, easier manageability turns into fewer people necessary to manage and save on labor, no?
Well, that's a really hard conversation to have with a bunch of system administrators in the room.
Yes.
They don't want to hear about things being easier. But the fact is, JIGPAC is a class, it used to be called JIGPAC, over in Makalapa Crater, a classic example. And they were one of the early adopters of thin clients. This was about 8 years ago. They went from 22 PC administrators to 3 after we implemented this thin client solution.
That's a lot of money.
Did they fire 18 administrators? No. They had needs all over. They were able to reassign them, give them jobs that they liked better than being a PC guy, train them on networking, train them on server. So it wasn't like the system administrators lost out. It was that it just became a more efficient environment, so they weren't being wasted on these other resources.
Yeah.
But if you're a systems administrator and, you know, I come in and do my talk about simplification and efficiency and storage, you tend to think you got a big X on your back. But that is not the fact. The good system administrators will always find work.
So what about speed? You know, of course, a few weeks ago, there's all this about the Google Gigabit thing,
mm-hmm.
which, I mean, I'd like to hear your mm-hmm. take on that. And then, was it yesterday, there was something about Cisco coming up mm-hmm. with an incredibly fast router or switch.
6 times what the current speed of the router is, yeah.
So mm-hmm. it sounds like we're going to have more speed, and I'd like to know how that affects these trends you're talking about.
Well, one, it enables software as a service much easier. because and it enables these virtualized environments to be created much easier because the end user experience is immaterial, right? I always like to say the fast is fast enough. If the end user hits the enter button and the data comes back this fast or it comes back this fast, the end user experience is irrelevant. It's the same experience. But what this larger piping allows us to do is it allows us to move up what we can stream. You know, it will no longer just be streaming regular television. It'll be streaming the next generation of high definition television. And by the way, America lags Asia amazingly in their bandwidth. We typically get to our PCs with cable modems and you know with the fiber. We tend to get 1 to 3 megabytes per second. That wouldn't even be acceptable in Japan. They're getting to the house 10, 20 megabytes per second. They're going to 100 megabytes per second. And as you increase that pipe, the content richness of what is being delivered is increased dramatically. So we are actually lagging most of the industrialized world in what we deliver from a bandwidth perspective to the end user.
Falling behind.
Yes.
But you know, one thing about that speed thing fascinates me. I think somebody said it in connection with the Cisco switch that they're coming out with. That is, you could put like millions of people on a conference, mm-hmm. on a video conference, mm-hmm. and they can all talk to each other mm-hmm. at the same time. And that really boggles or googles the mind.
Well, it's kind of a little bit of a marketing spin on that. The marketing spin is that that would be assuming everyone had that level of bandwidth, right? And they're not going to have that level of bandwidth to everyone's house. So that's still going to be the backbone, and the backbone will allow much higher transfers of data on the backbone of the internet, right? That's where those routers are going towards. They're going to that backbone. But, you know, I think it's a stated goal, I think of the Obama administration, to get to about 100 megabit per second delivered to the house.
Right. He said that before Google said it.
Yeah. So, you know, we are lagging. In bandwidth, we are lagging. Now, there are some reasons for that. We are a very large country spread all over the place compared to Japan, which is highly industrialized also, but has a much denser population footprint. You know, it's much easier to wing wire around to every house when it's much denser than that. So there are some reasons, you know. There's a reason a cowboy in Wyoming doesn't have, you know, 10 megabit per second. There's a reason.
But don't you think that when you have fast speed, really fast speed, mm-hmm. multiples fast, even faster than what they have in Asia right now, that will lead to new software of a kind that we haven't seen before.
Absolutely.
Because it has, you know, new possibilities.
Mm-hmm. Well, when you get to that level of speed, now you're talking about the ability to do 3D glasses, to do games that are totally immersive. Now you're getting to that land where eventually it will be totally an immersive experience because there's just so much bandwidth able to do that.
I have to say I really enjoy this kind of conversation, you know, to look forward and speculate, if you will, or project what's going to happen in the future. It's always so exciting.
Yeah.
And it always seems to move faster. And unless you pay attention to it, you're going to be toast.
Oh, yeah. Well, yeah, the old models will die. They always do. They just always do.
So how do you keep up? I mean, you're here, and New Mexico and Florida, whatever, they're all there.
Yeah.
How do you keep up with stuff, and how do you make yourself able to compete with companies in the same market, same space on the mainland?
Basically, because we're kind of unique, we were originated as an island company, and as an island company, let's face it, for years we were on our own. We got very little support from the mainland, so it was, you just had to have this mentality of, I got to do it myself. So we're very fierce that way, that we want to know what's best, we want to research, we want to have our hands in it. A lot of the mainland companies, there's so many resources available to them, they'll just co-op it to somebody else and get a manufacturer to do it or so-and-so to do it. Well, we couldn't do that in Hawaii for 10 years.
Right.
We couldn't do it. And so I think it's a mentality difference.
How do you do it, though? I mean, it sounds like it must be a combination of things. One is a lot of reading. I mean, regular reading, regular research, finding people to explain it or teach it. You know, and generally developing a culture where everybody in the shop is right up there. Mm-hmm. Because you need to be able to talk
language. We have an extremely technical organization. That helps. Second, Jay, I'm on a plane all the time. And when I'm on a plane, I'm not just meeting customers or my employees. More than half of my time is meeting vendors. Vendors wanting me to tell me about where they see the market going. Vendors telling me, giving me non-disclosures on new products that they have coming out that they want us to be interested. So I spend probably more of my time on the road getting briefings from high-tech companies about where they're going and where they see the future. That's one thing unique about being in Hawaii, but also having all these offices on the mainland. Versus, frankly, a lot of the local smaller mom-and-pop shops in Hawaii, they're not getting in the mainland. They probably have to do it by more of a brute force method of research, research, research. Frankly, because I travel so much, a lot of it's handed to me on a plate.
Yeah, so you have a huge advantage by having that network and the ability to travel around.
Exactly.
Is there anyone else in Hawaii, any other company that's in the same... It's in the same, you know, venue, the same space as you are?
Not of the applied technology companies. I don't. They do some business on the mainland, but we're so unique from that perspective that we're just different that way.
But you're an interesting model, though, because you're a model that's fully able and, in fact, proving it every day about doing business on the mainland. And that's what Hawaii should be doing. Hawaii should be selling intellectual property, you know, services of this nature. To everywhere in the world.
I think they would find that the pickings are actually kind of easy on the mainland, especially in our space, that there's a lack of expertise generally in the communities, and it's not just Hawaii, but just our mentality from that island perspective has made us a little more hardcore about it.
It's desirable, and we have the experience of dealing with clientele on the mainland, but you spoke about how advanced Asia is, and it makes me wonder whether we can compete in Asia.
We do not compete with commercial entities in Asia. It's not a market. It's a fairly closed market, frankly. So it's not a market that we're going to invest in. Where we do compete, and fiercely, is for military installations in Guam, Japan, and Korea. There is going to be a huge movement of Marines out of Okinawa into Guam. So they're building up a huge, large infrastructure in Guam. And frankly, they lack technical expertise in Guam. So we're spending an inordinate amount of time flying to Guam, spending time there. We're actually sending some gear there. We're going to have it house it there. We're going to be doing virtualization assessments, virtualization seminars. We'll be talking about cloud. A lot of what the Marine Corps want to do is they want to create some mini clouds in the data centers in Guam. So that's what we're doing from the Far East perspective. But we don't have a unique IP from the standpoint of we've invented something. Now, if a Hawaii company can invent something and find a consumer for it in the Far East, that's fine. But we are truly and classically an applied technology company. And when I say applied technology, I mean I take other people's stuff, I integrate it, I create the solution tailored towards the customer's needs. That's applied technology.
But you know, that's also IP in its own right.
Well, yeah, I mean, no one knows how to do some of the sauce we do in our virtualization schema, how we do our thin clients. But it's hard to identify and monetize that as an intellectual property because it is basically using off-the-shelf solutions and creating a solution with it. Anyone else could go and re-engineer it fairly easily. Well, not easily, but they could re-engineer it.
So it's just sort of like pre-IP. It's soft IP.
Yeah, soft IP.
Well, I wonder where the American position is because we, you know, a few years ago, not too many years ago, everybody in the world was buying whatever they needed from the U.S. Mm-hmm. Now that's just not the case anymore. And maybe it's this soft IP kind of thing that will actually lead the way. This, facilitation, integration, what's the modern word for it? You know, putting it all together in the stovepipe.
Creating a solution. It's interesting, though. You know, this last recession, worst recession since the Great Depression. I was a child of the 60s and 70s. I remember the 70s. I remember industry fleeing, the steel industry. And I remember in the late 70s, everyone's talking about how America is dead. We've lost our competitive edge. We're history as a country. It's the rise of the Far East story. Then even Europe was viewed in better light than us.
Yeah, yeah.
And the one beautiful thing about America is we're inventive, and we always reinvent ourselves. So every time I hear people talking about how this is the end of America, I still remember how much innovation is still created in America. Sure, the Chinese, the Japanese, the Koreans, they are excellent people at doing manufacturing, of creating, you know, solutions from technology that exists. Where they lag us is just that inventive nature, and I think it's just part of our DNA. It doesn't mean they won't develop it. It doesn't mean there aren't incredibly inventive people there, but as society as a whole, that's what we've always fallen back on as a society. And that's why I kind of laugh every time I see on, you know, some Fox News channel or CNN or whatever that this is the end of America as we know it. And I've heard that before.
Bill Gates ran around the country maybe 3 years ago, and he went to every college he could find, and he tried to gin up some interest in computer science because he felt that not enough people were studying computer science, and he felt that he could have an effect on that. Well, whatever he did, the fact remains that not as much interest exists on the American college campus as used to be for, you know, basic computer science. So I really wonder if you have trouble recruiting, where you get your people from, how you can assure yourself that they are at a level of interest and curiosity and training that will do the kinds of things you're talking about, what you get on the plane to do.
Well, I think if you once again look at the papers of the 70s, they'll talk about how we're losing our math edge, how, you know, there's, I mean, I've heard this multiple times. In the 80s, it was like, we got to get kids interested in computers, we're going to be left behind in dust. And, you know, there's something to be said for that. I'm not disavowing that, but I think it is never as grim as maybe it is painted by the press.
Do you have any problem finding people?
No.
Where do you get them from?
I run an ad. Right now, it's particularly easy to find people. There are some trouble spots. Washington, D.C. is notoriously a bad place to find people just because there's such a concentration and they're so used to jumping ship. A guy will take a job, be at it for 6 months, get offered 10,000 more, go there, be at it for 6 months. That culture is not looked down upon in Washington, D.C. as a whole. So since it's not looked down upon, you know, the jumping from job to job to job, it's culturally okay to do that in D.C. So we have a hard time finding good technical people. Salespeople we've had pretty good luck with, but technical people. And then the ones we find, generally, they're substandard compared to the people I can get in New Mexico or the people I can get in Hawaii. New Mexico is really nice because you have all the Department of Energy labs there. So you got Sandia National Labs, Los Alamos National Labs, and those are incubators for very good technology people. So that's one of the double beauties of New Mexico, having an office in Albuquerque. One, the rent is exceedingly low, and two, find people. Get good, talented people.
What are you looking for in the way of training? Do you want PhDs?
No. Oh, no, absolutely not. Before our current VP of engineering, our previous two VPs of engineering didn't have a college degree.
What are you looking for?
You got to look how good they are with a keyboard. You got to see what their skill set is. You know, it's applied technology. It's not book learning. It's how good can you take, because we are faced problems all the time. Something doesn't work exactly like it's supposed to. This virtual instance of OS keeps dropping out and crashing. Why is it? Okay, well, there's not a manual that says do this. It takes experience to do that. You need to sense it. You need to understand, I got it. I understand why it's doing this. You won't find it in a book. You have to learn by doing in our business.
And you as the employer have to figure out who fits in that category.
Exactly.
I'm sure it's not easy.
Well, and some people have strengths in certain areas and weaknesses in other areas. So as you're doing these professional service engagements, you know, you can't just send a body. A body is not a body. A body is a body. That's not the instance at all.
That won't work.
What are we trying to accomplish with this customer at this certain time? Who's the best asset we have? I will have people fly from Florida because I have some really good virtualization guys in Florida that have certain skill sets that my Hawaii guys don't have or haven't mastered yet. We'll fly them from Florida here for an engagement because that's the best.
So where are you? Florida? New Mexico?
We're in D.C. We're in Washington, D.C. We're in Florida. We're in San Antonio. We're in New Mexico. We're in Colorado Springs, San Diego, Hawaii.
So you cover the whole country. You're within an hour of any place in the country, it sounds like.
Basically, but our model is predicated upon actually doing business with the people in the territory you're at. Mm-hmm. Right, so we don't really do a lot of business like up in the Northwest, and we don't have anyone up there. We tend to get really concentrated and do a lot of business specifically in that location. San Diego is a classic example. We do a lot of business with Spaywar San Diego. My rep there is an excellent rep, does a great job, very knowledgeable, former systems engineer who decided to go into sales. That's what we like. We like sales reps who can speak intelligently of the product. But he is very, very concentrated in the greater San Diego area. He doesn't really branch out into the other areas because, frankly, he's doing enough business right there in San Diego.
I want to talk about the military, too. You mentioned the military. And I was listening yesterday or today about some of the incredible advances in military server technology. Mm-hmm. And as you alluded, they're focused on it now. They realize that maybe they're behind or they want to be out in front. Mm-hmm. And the whole military establishment seems to be focused on doing more and better around computers, which is a good realization. But there sounds like plenty of business involved there, and it also sounds like they want to be the best in the world, so they're looking for the best advice they can get, and it's an endless possibility of jobs, contracts, business, whatnot for you.
The biggest problem with the military, and you have to think about it from this perspective, and that is, while they have very, very good people, very intelligent people in some of these data centers, they have 18-year-olds running most of these computer systems.
That have
6 weeks of training.
Yeah.
So when you're in the boat in the middle of the ocean, and I shouldn't say a boat, a ship. Sorry. When you're in a ship in the middle of the ocean and the captain's email goes down, who fixes it? An 18-year-old who's had 6 weeks. So that's why especially those who specialize in doing information technology for what we call the point of the spear. So they've got the warfighter in the field, whether it be a person on a ship or a person in Afghanistan or what, that's the point of the spear. They have to have immense technology requirements. There's a lot of technology. They have to have command and control functionality. They have to be able to see the data around them. They have to have feeds from the drones coming in. That's an immense amount of technology. That's why for those resellers or integrators who work at those point of the spear, it's about simplification and efficiency. It's about how can I, it's no longer about fast. It is about how can I make it as easy as possible for Sailor Timmy in the middle of the ocean to fix the captain's email or to get command and control functionality back up.
In 1991, I went to visit one of the nuclear submarines at Pearl Harbor, and I was really surprised to find, although they had a lot of technology in the control room and the sonar and the radar and whatnot, they had one PC. They had one PC on a nuclear submarine. Is that still the case? I would imagine that between 1991 and now, I'm sorry, did I say 2001?
Oh, 2001.
2001.
I think actually probably what you're seeing there is more about security reasons. When they're on subs, they're deep and they're dark.
Yeah.
If a sailor goes on a sub, you will not see an email from them for months. So it's got nothing to do with the capability of providing access to a PC. It's the desire, the need to do it, because when those subs are out, they are dark.
So what do you see as a future for Hawaii, as in this area, your area? I mean, it sounds to me like you're a very vital company and you'll do great. But what about other companies in related spaces in Honolulu? Have we got a chance of becoming a center in server and computer technology?
Frankly, probably not. The big companies on the mainland, because you see when I mentioned how the OEMs are combining and creating vertical solutions, you're also seeing a combination of resellers on the mainland that are trying to offer larger and larger services. So as these resellers get larger and larger, they gobble up other resellers. And we're such a boutique reseller that I couldn't see us being one of those gobblers. As it becomes, software as a service becomes more relevant, it's just going to be services around that cloud. And if you can't provide the services around the cloud, selling a PC just ain't going to cut it anymore. I mean, I think 10, 15 years from now, people will not be buying PCs. They'll just they'll have access to whatever services they need with their PDA, and that will be it. So if you're in a traditional PC-based business, or even a traditional server-based business, not just Hawaii people, but mainland people, they're in for a long haul.
What about on the software side? In 10 years from now, do you think there'll be more people writing software or fewer?
Absolutely more. There will always be more people, especially as this bandwidth increases. So if you want to talk about what would be the future for Hawaii, it would be, where, as a software engineer, where would you rather live? Because 5-10 years from now, it won't matter where you live. You will commute from home, and you'll commute from whatever device that you decide to commute from. Do I want to live in Hawaii, or do I want to live in Wisconsin? It's a pretty simple answer.
What about you guys? I mean, isn't it a natural for you to migrate, not necessarily right now, but at some point, to software as a service or to other software that would complement what you're doing in the integration department?
Yeah, it is, and we're actually looking at managed services. When I mentioned that that model of the thin client, well, some of the engagements we're working on is where the customer actually wants to engage us to manage their infrastructure for them and manage those desktops. So they would pay us a fee on a monthly basis to manage the desktop. We would go set it up, we would create the infrastructure, and we would have people on board managing it. That is another ancillary area where I think people can go, and there are some places where that can happen. Now, If they're going to a straight software as a service model, that is not a relevant model. But a lot of these commands in the federal space, they're going to still say separated. So if you can go to a command and say, I'll manage all your desktops for X many bucks a month, mm-hmm. and I'll keep them up and running, and I will guarantee you this level mm-hmm. of service, that's definitely a viable model.
The other thing is, in your business, you know, you could maybe follow your own advice and get virtual.
We are. If you think about it, almost all our employees, that's usually, except for the Hawaii office, where the people are just used to coming into the office, generally don't go into offices. They work from home. They work virtually.
Well, that's great.
Yeah. I mean, they've got internet access. They've got cell phone access, and they'll go on sales calls. And they'll come back. The engineers, will virtually get together and decide who's going to do what project. So the only real physical offices we have a physical office in D.C., but no one ever goes there just because they don't have to. And traffic in D.C. is just absolutely miserable.
Driven by traffic.
Albuquerque, New Mexico, and Hawaii are the only traditional places where any employee at CDS goes into an office.
That's great. It really is taking your own advice.
Yeah. Well, if I had to do it all over again, I'd make it totally virtual.
It will be in the future.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah, maybe it will be.
So what have we learned here? I mean, what is your advice to the government of Hawaii? What's your advice to the legislature? What would you say we ought to do in order to play this card to make Hawaii, a more productive place in terms of computer services like the kind you're providing?
Well, I actually think the state of Hawaii needs, we call it eating our own dog food at CDS, right? You got to eat your own dog food. You got to do what you say you do. So I really think that the cutting edge for the state of Hawaii would be to unify their IT infrastructure. They could even farm out to somebody to provide it as a service at a much lower cost basis than what they're currently doing. It would be much more efficient because right now, prep in the state, you have all these fiefdoms of IT, and they constantly want to hug their own server. They're not willing to give up that software as a service. And more than I mentioned the University of New Mexico, there's that pressure in the University of New Mexico. Certain IT departments do not want to relinquish control. Eventually, you're going to have to. And if we were able to create a efficient, cheaper internal IT department in the state of Hawaii as a demonstration to the community at large at what can be accomplished, it could become a showcase. And it could save money. But it's hard to show that up front. The biggest problem with something like this is showing a return on investment. How do you calculate ROI, return on investment? And in the nether world of managed costs and how much does this body cost me and how much time am I really spending maintaining, it's hard to sometimes nail that down.
Yeah, so it's hard to quantify it.
Yeah.
But would you agree with me with the thought I've had for a long time is that a society or a community that has a better computer system, more efficient computer system, a higher level pass or whatever, a better software, is going to be a more productive community. It's going to be a community which works better in general at every level.
Absolutely. There is no question about that. There is no question about that. And in fact, right now we're engaged with, I don't want to say names, we're engaged with one of the larger providers of internet in Hawaii to basically look at re-architecting their entire infrastructure to doing this consolidation, increasing efficiency, lowering power costs, and thereby bringing us in as the trusted advisor to say, help.
That's great.
How
Mark.
Do we do this?
That's
and,
great.
You know, if we can set that up as an example and successful with it, then maybe we can finally go to the state and see, this was a pretty complex environment, and we simplified it greatly. So why can't we do that with the state? Fortunately, you just have this island mentality, and you have these fiefdoms that, it will take a long time of beating people over the head, frankly, before you break down those walls.
Do you know what? If you had an iconic success mm-hmm. with a large institution, say the university, and you made it work and mm-hmm. you could, you may not be able to numerically demonstrate mm-hmm. it, but you could demonstrate it logically anyway, that it was more efficient, mm-hmm. it was working better, problems that existed before had been resolved because of it, mm-hmm. Operational problems, then you could say to the next guy, mm-hmm. look, this is a proof of the concept.
Yeah, exactly.
So you should do it too.
Exactly. I mean, we've done these installations on the mainland, so yeah. It's not like it's something new to us. But still, in Hawaii, it's kind of provincial, and things move slower.
But we could make a laboratory. You're part of making it a laboratory.
Absolutely.
Good for you.
Absolutely.
You're the center of our laboratory effort in this department.
I'll take that gladly.
one more question.
Yeah.
If you have a moment, and that is the computer industry in general. It seems mm-hmm. consolidating, and certain companies are surfacing. And it seems to me, just watching the market, that that's a good investment. What do you think of investing in these very same companies that are manufacturing and integrating hardware and software and stove pipes and whatnot?
I think in the future you won't have very many other companies to invest in because of the consolidation. I mean, there's rumors all the time now, very large players like EMC. EMC is a very large storage company, the largest storage company in the world. The question is, who's going to acquire them? It's no longer, are they going to remain independent? It's who's the list of people that are going to acquire EMC, because you can't make a model out of being a standalone storage house anymore.
And it's hard to find somebody so big that they can acquire
exactly.
them,
too. But there are companies big enough to acquire EMC, and I can tell you that right now.
Are there companies big enough to acquire CDS?
I don't think anyone.
You don't have to answer that.
I don't think anyone would want to acquire us. We're this little reseller in Hawaii. We have kind of that moniker, even though we do great things. They're the Hawaii guys.
Well, should it ever happen, I hope you'll come and talk to me again about it.
Oh, of course, Jay. Of course.
Thank you, Mark.
Thank you so
Mark
much,
Gilbert,
Jay.
CDS. Thanks for being here.
Appreciate it. Bye-bye.